ukuthi umzingwane dam which was the second dam commissioned, and I'm sure you can see the intake tower. The intake tower has four levels which are visible. Three are visible. The other one is just on the other side of the dam. So it is from those intake levels that we draw water, starting with the highest when the dam is full and to the lowest when the dam is empty. So when we say we've decommissioned the dam, we don't close any valve. The water just comes below the intake level, and thereafter it becomes impossible for water to be actually pumped from this dam. All the processes are actually gravity. So from here, water to Mwema treatment works actually goes by the gravity system. Then the other issues that have always been raised here is about siltation in the dams. As you can note, we are almost right at the bottom of the river, Mzingwane. And we still have dead water within the system. And if we are to desilt this dam, it means we are actually deepening the current basin. And when you deepen the current basin, you actually be increasing the amount of dead water, so that before you can actually abstract water, more water is to flow into the dams before we start using the dam. So the issues of siltation that have actually been widely spread, I'm sure it's evident that it's very minimal, it's there, but it has not affected as yet the operational capacity of our dams. It is the same scenario that you'll find if you go to Lower Nwema and Upper Nwema. I thank you. A treatment on site and two pumping houses. The treatment on site established as far back as 1942 when we started pumping to the city. Then the other two pump stations established much later. From here we treat water and pump it as clear water to the city. Then we pump raw water, which we pump to Criterion Waterworks, which we will see when we close our program, where it's treated. And there are two pumping stations that are there. One is called the Sauza, the other one is called the KSB. The KSB was commissioned in 1973, mainly delivering raw water to Criterion. Since 1973, those pumps were working almost daily, 24 hours a day, 365 days. You can calculate how many years those pumps have been running. And because of their age, we had to actually come up with a replacement program, which is the program that we are currently working under this week, which is looking at the rehabilitation of those pumps so that we maintain. The projects were meant to be commissioned in early March, but because of COVID issues, it had to be extended. So now we're targeting that these pumps will actually start being operational by the 25th of November this month. The pumps design are to deliver almost 90 megaliters of water per day. That's one pump set. So we have two pump sets. The new pumps that are called FlowSafe that are replacing the old KSB line. Then we also have the Sauza pumping system. So those are the two pumping systems that are pumping raw water, and their capacity in total for both of them is about 108 megaliters per day to deliver water into the city. That is if water is available. The project, as we saw it, is now almost 84% complete, with most of the work, civil works, almost complete. The pumps have already been put on site. You will see that on this installation, and also at Fenny, which is just a duplicate of what you will see here. Upon commissioning,
On the 25th, we hope there will be water to pump. Because currently our production, raw water from the dams because of the three decommissioned dams, is just about 80 megaliters per day. And the cells are pumped itself, actually pumps that all to the city without having to get assistance from the new pumping system that we have. So we're hoping within the short period we'll get inflows so that we'll start utilizing the full capacity of the pumps. I know people have said we have no pumping capacity, but I think the challenge that the city has is not pumping capacity, but raw water availability, which is currently what is constraining us. I think when we get to site, the consultant, the consultant, I think like the safety lady has already said, he will take us through the work that has been done and you'll see what has been done on this site. Then from there we'll proceed to Fenil. We have a similar duplicate pumping equipment at Fenil that is also under installation. I think we can proceed, then the consultant will take us through the works on the ground.
Afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm engineer Ndlovu for the city of Bulawayo. And I'm standing in for the city of Bulawayo in the execution of this project. We are trying to resuscitate the pumping capacity of our water to the city. The pumps that were here, as the director has already alluded, were now extremely old. They were always breaking down. Spares were very difficult to find. So we embarked on a program of renewing our strategies. These pumps are straight from Europe. They are to European standards, not any other standard, but EU standard, straight from France. These pumps are going to run two at a time, not where you run one pump and you destroy it. They will be running in parallel. But what we've done is, we have tried to reduce the intervention of a human being by incorporating a system that we refer to as SCADA, S-C-A-D-A, which stands for Supervisory Control and Data Acquisition. Whatever is happening here will be communicated to someone at Criterion, Benside. So if someone wants to change the operation of the pumps, he doesn't need to come here, he just come down. If there is a problem, the pumps communicate with an electrician or a mechanical technician without someone having to try to phone someone. So the machines will be communicating amongst themselves and also communicating with us. That way it reduces the risk of someone making a mistake and breaking the machines. According to our program, we expect these machines, we expect to start, you know, commissioning process on the 15th of this month, and by the 25th we will have finished the process of commissioning. When we commission, we mean the machines are now ready to deliver water to the city, but the water has to be there first. So hopefully hopefully by then, as the director has said, it will have rained. I heard some bit of thunder, maybe, because it was announcing good news. Yes.
I think when I was explaining that side, I said you will have two pump stations. The other Salsa pump station is the one that is next to. That's the one that is running. And it has also three sets of pumps. And we have three sets of similar pumps at Feni, which you see. But currently, because of raw water, it's just running one pump continuously for 48 hours. Otherwise, I think this is what we have. I'm sure people can come in and have a look from that end.
As I said, when you are in criterion, you will be able to see even the temperatures of the machine is running. You can tell the temperatures of this machine from down. You don't have to come here. What we call surge. In electrical terms, this would act as a surge diverter, but this is a hydro surge vessel. It has a tendency of absorbing some of the excess pressures. However, if it's too, the pressure is too much, ama pipes sometimes are so warm. So this huge tank here will alleviate the situation by absorbing excess pressure within the pipeline. The old system did not have that, but with these new pumps, we saw it fit to make sure we attenuate the pressure, because we always have a lot of, pipe burst along from here to So this vessel here is going to solve that problem. But this, you see, there's almost a meter down. A meter already down there of this concrete. So once it's done, you won't see it. It will be there, a big backfield. You will only see part of this top here. And the vessel. Once we have two sets of pumps or pump houses, we will be able to run one during peak periods and run both during off peak. That will actually help reduce the pumping costs. In that the peak charges are $1.05. $1, not $1.05 per kilowatt hour. And these are mega watt machines. So if we are able to run less machines during peak period, we will pay less. And during off peak, we run all of them and we fill our reservoirs.
That cost, that benefit also trickled down to the consumers, which is in this case the residents, or it's something that you maintain?
No, currently, you know, the charges take into account the peak and the off peak, and then they aggregate. So it has always been like that. Even now, when we have no facility for pumping more on off-peak, we still charge them aggregated charges.
Yeah. Thank you.
Taking from the other side and the lower end, coming somewhere in between.
I'm told, Simon, some people can view it from this end, some can view it from that other end. Then you see there is a satellite installation on the building as you go around. Basically, that is to allow that any fault that happens in that pump, it comes to the phone of the supervisor or the phone of the maintenance technicians. Meaning, if CITOC now had money, would do the same for those two pumps, and there will be no one here to look after the station other than the people that are watering the lawns and keeping the place tight. So let's feel free, then we tow here, then we go that side, then from there we'll be going to Criterion where we'll end our tour. I think.
This is the new equipment that we are installing here. It's also from Europe. This is Anger, the project that is attached to the pumps. I can see someone saying, oh, it's for this. There's another project that will end this one. So for now, we are going with this. As you can see, this is our starter. This starter has three components. There is the main breaker, there is the soft starter, and the power factor correction unit. ZESA has said we need to be within a certain power factor. If we are below, we are now charged. So we had to incorporate the power factor operation capacities so that we are within the prescribed the power factor. This system works in conjunction with the scatter system. It's not yet installed, it's here. And then this system is connected to the satellite transmission system. As you can see, there are people working outside. They are putting up communication with Criterion. Not only with the Criterion, this will also communicate with NEMA. They will put a similar system which will from NEMA that will communicate with the FENI, two-way communication. And then these will then communicate with Criterion. As I said, you no longer need to be here to start anything. You start from Criterion. Any pump of these new pumps. You just sit there, you touch the screen and the pump starts. That's the technology that we have. So we go to another section of the plant. So these are the filters. And if from here you can actually tell which filter is running. And if there's an incident that happens, a nasty incident, you just bring in the investigators, you play them. They don't have to take time. They will see what actually happened. Maybe somebody commits suicide, throws himself in there. You can see from the recordings, you see him throwing himself in, and the case is over. And the system is such that when you are the other side and you are talking, you can be heard from here, but those people can't hear you. Maybe they are planning to pose and they are talking, let's throw in. You will hear them talk. As you can see, this is real time. These people are down here right now. And during this is the new installation that we installed. Yes. So you can show the backwash pumps. The area with the backwash. Is this one?
Yes.
So if maybe you want to start a pump, you can actually even see that there are people working on this one or that one or that one, rather than injuring people. You just, there are people working there. But even then, we have put in a safety precaution that if someone wants to work there, you actually locally deactivate the system. So even if you want to start, you can't. As long as the person downstairs doesn't activate for you to go there. So these are the works, some of the works that we did under this. So we decided that the best thing is maybe to do a tour, a visual tour rather than physical.
Trips, we always tell the consumers that we have got power challenges because ZESA is cheap. But this was meant to actually cover for such eventuality. In other words, when you have got 10 days storage, even if it trips at NEMA and we are not pumping at NEMA for 5 days, the consumers won't feed it because we'll then be continuous. We thought this is important so that people have an appreciation. Some have said you should put a standby generator at NEMA, but this was the cheaper option to have capacity that is actually on standby in the event of our loss of power. Then our reservoirs also have a total storage capacity of almost 72 hours. So when we lose power, we've got 72 hours within the reservoirs, and you're almost 10 days storage within the raw water. And that should sustain the city without people feeling the disruptions in terms of power.
We are saying because of lack of raw water, your buffer storage is now totally depleted. So whenever you have power outage, the residents will feel it because we will then say we are closing reservoirs because we are feeding life. But normally when things are normal, this reservoir has storage to last us for a minimum of 10 days. So whenever there is electricity failure or equipment failure, the residents don't feel it, which is why we won't be advertising that we have lost power in the normal. It's only now that we were pumping directly into the system that people, when we lose power for those few hours, consumption is still ongoing, but we won't be bringing in any water, which is why residents feel it immediately. But when this dam is full, you won't feel, you know, we won't be announcing that there is no power.
So when the city declares that there's no water for the whole city, it means you'll be no pumping it all from any other?
Yes, when we say there is no water, like I'm saying that we are now working on a life system. It's like you're drinking on a pot. Mm-hmm. And that pot is dependent on electricity being pumped. When electricity stops, the pot also dries up. Okay. So this is why we're saying when electricity goes out, when electricity is down or the pumps are at fault, immediately residents now feel it because this buffer is no longer there.
Isn't the first time for this reservoir to dry up, or it has happened before? My other question is the project that you are implementing. Previously, I know council said that it had been affected by COVID, and there were some additional monies that you needed to complete the project, and you have stated that you expect to commission it at the end of this month. Has all the money been provided for the completion of this project?
Good question. What we did at the end of COVID was to engage with the contractors in terms of what are the additional costs. Which additional costs we had to look at. In the total project summary, we had to rationalize. There are some projects like studies that we have put on hold. We are applying through government for additional funding to actually cover those projects. But for these projects that are currently being implemented, all of them will be completed within the current budget allocation, except for the studies.
Which are those studies?
The waste, the water recycling study for industrial use, and also
the Kami one,
yes, and also the ring fencing of the water services, so that water can account for its expenditure and its incomes without getting subsidies from other accounts. So that's part of the second study that is there, that has been put on hold. And also the tariff, is our tariff very fair? We've had debate where people are saying, is it proper to give everyone 5 kiloliters of water per day for free? So that study was going to look at that and also come up with a way we should structure our tariffs so that at the end of the day, the water account remains afloat with those four poor provisions.
Okay. Maybe how much money has been utilized so far, and how much deficit is there?
The studies will be costing in the region of about 600,000. That's what has been deferred. But out of the 33 million that has been allocated, all the projects are still within that amount to actually be done and be completed by the bank, from the bank.
And then my other question about this place drying up. Is it the first time in history, or it has happened before?
It's the first time in history. I think the issues of climate change are starting to show. We've been indicating that the inflows from our dams continue to decline almost every season. And you know that Bulawayo dams normally fill up when there are cyclones. So actually I'm concerned when we are saying we have normal to above normal rains. We might end the season with those three dams still decommissioned. And that's the biggest scare that we have at the moment. But this is the first time I'm seeing it. We haven't got anything through the books that this dam has actually dried up to this extent. But it has gone to, it has been decommissioned as well on several occasions, but there will still be some water for the fish. But as you can see this time around, there's totally nothing left in the